everyone. Welcome to another moment of At Those Times with me, Chantel Graces. I'm going to take you to a passage in my book, At Those Times. Romans 8 verse 1 says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." In my devotion, I share, "At those times when I'm ashamed of what I've done, help me to forgive myself. Forgiveness is a part of the healing process. I don't always feel good after I've done wrong, but your Spirit will guide me moving forward." I'm going to stop right there because sometimes we mess up. Sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes we fall short and we might even feel bad about it. But I want to encourage you and let you know that you don't have to beat yourself down. The Bible says there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. So if you feel like the enemy or even your flesh and your mind is trying to bring guilt and shame, you can cast those things down and say, "God, I am redeemed because of you." You can repent today, confess your sins, and know that he is faithful and just to hear you and to forgive you of your sins. So I want to encourage you and let you know that if you've slipped up this week, it happens. If you messed up in any kind of way, I've been there. But God is faithful and he will sustain us. So be encouraged, you all. Have a wonderful week and thank you for watching again.
Good morning, Nazarene.
Morning.
Welcome to Sunday morning at Nazarene Baptist Church.
I got Jesus.
Jesus, I got him all my life.
You can still give your offering through Tithely. You can also drop off your tithes and offerings at Nazarene Baptist Church Wednesdays at 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. We can all help prevent suicide. This Lifeline provides 24/7 free and confidential support for people in distress. Prevention and crisis resources are available for you or your loved ones. Please call the number below. Easter is coming. Come and be a part of our Easter Sunday production. To volunteer, contact Sister Sharon at the number provided on the screen.
Hey everybody.
Hi everyone.
We're Lawrence and Chantel Snells.
And we'd like to invite you to Life Talk with Youth and Young Adults.
Join us this Saturday at 4 p.m.
We are building confidence in our youth. We are praying for each other. We are sharing testimonies. We even have some featured speakers, so you don't want to miss this.
So we look forward to seeing you this Saturday again at 4 p.m.
We'll see you guys there.
See ya.
Virtual Bible Study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. Join the prayer conference call, Sundays at 10 a.m.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to all the February birthdays.
To you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
The Wellness Challenge of 2021. This week's health tip, B vitamins. Eat your B's. B vitamins reduce stress in the brain, promotes energy, and enhances focus. Who doesn't want all of those things? Vitamin B12 isn't the only one important B vitamin for good health. Other B vitamins, specifically vitamins B3, B5, B6, and B7 are also important. If you eat a plant-based diet, you can easily get through. Some of the best sources of B vitamins include nuts, seeds, leafy greens, broccoli, avocado, root vegetables, coconut, beans, including coffee and cocoa, bananas, pumpkin, berries, and whole grains. Mix these up throughout the day for a healthy brain all day long. Did you know that black men built the Capitol? It was the mid-1850s and the U.S. Capitol was under construction, with plans for a new dome and a statue to sit on top of it. At first, the sculptor of this statue wanted to create the likeness of a freed slave. The statue would simply be titled Freedom. Meet the black inventor who created the first digital cell phone. Many people attribute the invention of the smartphone to the Europeans, but in fact, the first digital cell phone was invented by an African-American man named Jesse Eugene Russell. The potato chip was invented by a black man named George Crumb. There are a few stories about the invention of the potato chip, but the most reliable ones all center around George Crumb, a famous black chef in the 19th century who served the wealthiest Americans and eventually opened his own wildly successful restaurant.
That you would gather your elements of bread or cracker, your water or your juice, as we prepare to partake of the Lord's table together. Let us pause and pray. Father, we thank you for your divine provisions. We thank you for another day of life. We pray now, O God, in the name of Jesus, that you would forgive us of every sin, O God. We also pray, Father, that you would consecrate these elements. Change them, O God, from that of a carnal use into that of a spiritual use. And we'll forever give your name the praise and glory and honor that's due. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jesus said, as often as you do, to do this in remembrance of him. In other words, renew your mind around what he has done. Let it be a reminder to you of the victory that God has given up to us as his children. So as we stare at the cross afresh, I believe that healing is going to take place. I believe that faith is going to arise again. This is a sacred time. I would that you would concentrate your minds and your hearts to be on the Lord Jesus Christ as we remember his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Just as Jesus had assembled his disciples on that Monday, Thursday, he took bread, he blessed it and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take ye, eat it all, for this is a symbol of my body, which will be broken for you." Brothers and sisters, let's eat together. Somebody say, "Thank you, Jesus." Again, Jesus reaches for the table. He grabs the wine, he blesses it, and he disperses it to his disciples and says, "Take ye, drink all of it, for this is a symbol of my body, of my blood, which will be shed in the remission of your sins." Brothers and sisters, let us drink together. As often as we do this, we do show forth the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Would you take a moment and just celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ with me and give him the glory for the greatest thing that he's ever done for you? Thank you, Jesus. We love you today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Until the next time, be blessed.
Yahweh. Hey! Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we give you glory and honor for this, a brand new day. This is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Despite our hesitancies, our challenges, we are dedicated to demonstrate that we will bless you at all times, and your praise shall continually be in our mouths. We thank you for all that you continue to do, how you continue to move through us, for us, and in us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, our substitute for sin and suffering. And we thank you for the Holy Ghost that we feel even now. We pray that you would give us a fresh outpouring of your anointing today. Let your glory fill every house, every place and space where your people are worshiping. We pray that burdens be removed and yokes be destroyed, and that joy will be lifted up in the hearts of your people. We come putting our trust and our faith in you. You, O God, who has never lost a battle, nor will you ever lose one, because we know that victory comes and ends with you. You are God. You are God all by yourself. And you are a God who is always many steps ahead of us. And we thank you that you are faithful to always go before us and to be with us. Thank you, Lord, because we know that no matter what mountain that we come up against, you have already made a way for us to overcome. We are confident, God, that no matter what journey of uncertainty that we may encounter, you, Lord, are our waymaker. You will make a way where there seems to be no way. Because, God, we know that you are faithful and you are good. We don't know what the future holds, nor the battles that we will face, nor where the opposition will come from. But what we do know is that you are good, and that you are a stronghold in the day of trouble. We do know that you are our protector. We do know that you are our shield and our fortress. And we know that your word says that you would go before us and make the crooked path straight. We do know that it's your word that offers us assurance. So Lord, we just thank you for another day that you have allowed us to see and to come together corporately to worship you. Now get the glory out of everything that is said and done and expressed unto you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we have made a choice to rejoice and be glad in it. Certainly, we thank God for a brand new day, a day that we've never seen before, and a day that we'll never see again. So let's take this time to extend our greetings to one to another, and to all our family and friends who are joining us today that are not members of our church. We bid the blessings of the Lord be upon your life and your household. Now, would you grab your copy of God's Word and turn with me to 2 Samuel chapter number 12, beginning right there at verse number 1. 2 Samuel chapter 12, beginning at verse number 1. And it reads as thus: And the Lord sent Samuel unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had an exceeding flock of and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had brought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drink of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was coming to him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said unto Nathan, "As the Lord liveth, the man that has done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity." I want to talk to you this morning for just a few moments from the subject of divine reiterations. There are some things that we often don't hear until we hear it in a voice that comes back to us. And that's what we call a divine reiteration of words. You see, God has called us, and what he's looking for are not merely echoes, but he's looking for a voice. A voice that produces a divine reiteration of words. Let's just call it an echo. When a voice is spoken, an echo will often boomerang it back. And I believe that God wants us to be able to have echoes, because what we are speaking out to others, we need to take heed to it ourselves. And here in our text this morning, we find a man that we are very familiar with by the name of King David, a man who had clean hands, but a very dirty heart. He's ordered that a man be killed, even though he didn't do the killing. His hands were clean, but his heart was dirty. The Lord didn't go to the one who actually did the killing. He went to the one who had ordered the hit. And David was that man. And isn't it amazing here how the prophet Nathan created a parable? Because oftentimes we don't know how to judge ourselves in knowing what we ought to do when we're faced with a situation. We don't know how to give ourselves judgment based on what we would have done. You know why? Because we judge ourselves based upon our intentions, and we judge other people based on their actions. We judge them strictly on what they did, but we judge ourselves based on what we meant to do. We often justify ourselves by saying, "I didn't mean to hurt them." And we try to justify and rationalize the behavior based upon our intentions. We would often say that "I never meant for anyone to get hurt by this." Why? Because we often judge ourselves by a different standard than we do the world. That's why God used the prophet Nathan to paint a picture for King David, so that he would see himself in that picture. And I don't know how many of you have ever been used by God to counsel someone, but when someone else needed counseling, you became as sedacious as Solomon himself. And isn't it amazing how God gives us great words of wisdom and counseling in helping to figure out other folks' problems? We always seem to know what someone else needs to do. We can see what's wrong with them so clearly. But isn't it amazing how the gift of God that is in you can be used through us to bless other people? But when we're dealing with our own situations and dilemmas, we're left wondering, "Lord, what in the world do I do about my own issues? Because, Lord, I don't understand how you can use me to help somebody else, but yet I'm stuck with my own situations and dilemmas. So I am befuddled in knowing what I ought to do. What's the best steps for me to take right now? I can see so clearly for my brothers and sisters, for my neighbors and for my co-workers, but Lord, I need a word for myself." Isn't it strange how God can use us in such a powerful way to be a blessing to other people? And we need that same anointing, that same revelation to be able to come our way. And so what Nathan did was to tap into the wisdom of David for the nation. And he painted a picture. And David got tricked, because when Nathan painted the picture, he put David in the picture in a different form. He didn't recognize himself. And he was able to counsel himself without prejudice or bias. And when he painted this picture, he showed him that there was a rich man that had a lot of these lambs. And there was a poor man that didn't have but one. And that lamb that man had was just like one of his children. And then David, this king, who couldn't see himself in the picture, the rich man that didn't kill any of his flock to prepare for the traveler, but he took this poor man's only lamb and had it slaughtered. And yet he didn't see. David now comes with the judgment and says, how dare anyone be so insensitive, so cruel of heart? The man who has done this thing shall be put to death. And he's going to repay fourfold for what he's done. But little did he know that he was pronouncing his own judgment. After now the counsel and the wisdom of God has flowed out of David's life, then Nathan the prophet says, David, I'm talking about you. I wasn't talking about a rich man. I was talking about you. And it had nothing to do with a lamb, but everything to do with someone else's wife. David, you have many wives, and this man didn't have but one. And this man has served you loyally, and this is the way that you repay him? You take the only thing he had to love and support him, and you took it and had him killed and brought his lamb into yourself. Now the words that you have spoken will come back to judge your house, and adversity will never leave your house. You'll never know sometimes that the very choices you make, how they may affect the lives of your children. And what you bring back, when you sow to the wind, you'll reap the whirlwind back into your own house. So you have to be careful how you live your life in treating other people, because something will come back in boomerang into the lives of your very own children. And isn't it something that somehow God gives us the ability to be able to speak truth and to speak wisdom? So that now, through the echoes of what we've said to someone else, we have to bring those very words back and apply them to our own lives. That's what I meant by a divine reiteration of words, because there are some things that you only hear in the voice of confirmation. Every time God speaks, he'll speak one time from the heavens and one time from the earth. That's why when God called Moses, there was a divine reiteration. He said, Moses, Moses. When he called Abraham, he didn't just call him once. He said, Abraham, Abraham. When he called Samuel, he just didn't call him one time. He called him Samuel, Samuel. one time from the heavens and one time from the earth. Because every time, without exception, when God speaks to you from heaven, he will always confirm it in the earth. And if God has not confirmed it in the earth, then don't take it as from God. Because God will always speak in the voice of double annunciation, that what he declares from the heavens, as it is in heaven, so shall it be on the earth. He will always, whatever he declares in heaven, he will use somebody in the earth to confirm everything that he has spoken from heaven. So there's always a reiteration, a divine echo, so that when he speaks, when he begins to declare, and he says that whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven, there is a divine echo that God is trying to say, that if you don't get it the first time, listen and hear it the second time. He's saying to us in a different form here that the word of God is like a double-edged sword. It's got one blade that will cut going out and another that will cut coming back in. So whatever is good for the goose is also good for the gander. And so he's saying that when you speak something, every word that you speak, you shall give an account of it. Every idle word that you sow out to someone else is coming back to judge you in your own life. That's a divine reiteration. You see, it's easy to tell people to do the right thing. But how many have discovered that that's easier said than done? And how many of you have had the gift of God where you can work out all of your friends' problems and your relatives' problems, your co-workers' problems? I mean, the Lord just gives you wisdom and shows you what's wrong with everyone else. I mean, he just shows you the solution, but you have issues of your own and you feel stuck. There is a word that comes from God. So let's pull a few principles from the word of the Lord here this morning. And one of the principles that we can pull out of this is that whatever is buried when it rains is coming back up. In other words, whatever is done in the darkness will come to light. What God is saying is, be not deceived. In other words, don't fool yourself. God is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. You may get by, but you'll never get away. It'll come back to haunt you. Listen, be not deceived. Don't fool yourself. Don't trick yourself. Whatever you sow, you gonna reap. If you try to bury something, when it rains, it's gonna come back up. Because what you have buried was like a seed, and as soon as water hits it, it's going to come back up. So that's the first principle that we learn. That whatever is buried, when it rains, it's going to come back up. And here's the second lesson that we learned. That it's better to prepare and prevent than it is to repair and repent. It's better to prepare and prevent than it is to repair and repent. Let me tell you this. If you've messed up, the best thing that you can do is to repent. So it's best just to admit it and leave it alone. If you are in error, don't try to cover it up. Because whatever you try to cover up is coming back up. So if you've already messed up, confess it, repent of it, and turn away from it. Repentance is a change of mind. Repentance is not saying, I'm just sorry. Repentance is a change of mind. And there should always be what's called the fruit of repentance. The fruit of repentance are works, actions, and behaviors that confirms that this person has changed. We don't want an apology. We want repentance. We want change. We want to see a metamorphosis in someone's life. You don't want someone to just keep offending you and just keep saying that I'm sorry, and then a few months down the road, they're doing it all over again. No, you don't want an apology. You want repentance. And so it's always better to prepare and prevent than it is to repair and repent. But if you've done wrong, the best thing that you can do is to repent so that you can repair it. So we learn that as a principle from the word of the Lord. And here's the third principle that we learn. What happened to David when David heard the story without recognizing that he was the key character? David became furious. He said, the unmitigated gall of someone to have done that. David said that they deserve the death penalty. Here's the principle. We hate in others what we cannot stand in ourselves. Let me say that again. We hate in others what we cannot stand in ourselves. So if we see a quality or a trait that is in someone else, or something that we have not dealt with ourselves, you see, we hate in other people what we really can't stand in ourselves, and we want to kill it in them because we're really trying to kill it in us. We can't stand it in other people what we hate in ourselves. Here's the final principle that we learn. Is that when whatever is born of the flesh must always be sustained by the flesh. David and Bathsheba conceived something through a sinful act. And she was now pregnant. But the word of the Lord had come and said, listen, what you have conceived is going to have to die. Because it was conceived in the flesh and is going to die in the flesh. Because God was saying, I am not by my spirit going to come in and put on life support something that you gave birth to. Whatever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. But the act that happened between David and Bathsheba was not born of God. Let me put it this way. When you birth something in the flesh, you got to keep it in the flesh to sustain it. And that's the difference between something being resurrected and something being resuscitated. Resuscitation comes by the will of man. It's like putting a defibrillator on a person to resuscitate the heart to bring them back. But whenever you raise them by those means, you got to keep that support going into them. See, whatever is resuscitated will die again, but whatever is resurrected will never die. And that's why whenever you have something, if it's been born of God, you'll never lose what he resurrects in your life. When God raises you, when he absolutely resurrects your life, you will never die again. That's why Jesus says, if any man believeth in me, he shall never die, because he is the resurrection, the truth, and the life. But if what you have is something that is the works of the flesh, you may have taken it but you can't keep it alive. If you got it by ill means, it's gonna die on you. And the very thing that attracted you will now begin to repulse you. And this is where David was. He was in a position in life where he had stolen something that looked good to him at the time. He tried everything he could to keep life in it. He went on a fast. He put on sackcloth and ashes, and he wouldn't eat anything. He stretched out on the floor and began to pray and intercede. But when you're trying to keep something alive by the means of the flesh that God never birthed or intended to live, especially when it was birthed out of order, it's gonna die. But here's the good news. God is a God of grace and redemption. Hallelujah. The first thing was born of the flesh, but the second one was born by the will of God. And it had on the inside of it the greatest wisdom. And sometimes our greatest wisdom comes out of our greatest failures. And if you would just be determined in your own heart not to give up and keep on pushing and hear the very same words that God has used you to speak to someone else and put those words into action for your own self. Learn how to stand in the mirror and preach to yourself. Prophesy over yourself and let what God has used you to be a blessing to others bless you. I'm going to encourage myself in the Lord, because every now and then it's a good thing to become just a little selfish with it, because we all get down at times, and you've got to come to a place in God where you have to say to yourself, son of man, can these bones live again? You got to become your own Ezekiel and prophesy to your own bones. You got to say, get up, bones, get up, knees. Come back to me, mind. Come back to me, thoughts. Because there is too much work to be done. You got to preach to yourself in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 16:16 says, by mercy and truth, iniquity is purged. Mercy and truth. Don't just give people mercy without telling them the truth. You see, sin comes out of their life not just because you have prayed, Lord, have mercy. It's nothing wrong with that prayer. It's a good prayer to pray because we all need it. But Proverbs 16:16 says, by mercy and truth. Don't keep pleading for mercy if you don't tell people the truth. God has had mercy because of the prayers. But let me tell you the truth. The Spirit of God will not always strive with man. And if you don't straighten up your ways now, prayers, mercy, it can only be held back, but for so long. So when I prayed mercy for you, it was just keeping the judgment off of you until you have had a chance to get it right yourself. I have to tell you the truth. It's by mercy and by truth that iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord do men depart from evil. There has got to become a fear of God. And that is the one thing that David had. Even though he was a weak man, he was not a wicked man. Because the minute that David saw himself in the picture, he realized that he had sinned. Woe is me! David realized that he was the man. So he accepted the responsibility, and God had mercy on him and gave him another chance. He was restored by mercy and truth because Nathan had enough truth in him to let him know. He brought mercy, but he also brought truth. Never give folks mercy without telling them the truth, because you will be doing them a disservice. And that same wisdom that God is bringing out of you for others, you have to learn how to apply it to yourself. There's a blessing in your mouth, so don't just allow other people to get it and you walk away destitute. Woe be unto me if I preach to others and become a castaway myself. Where you have spoken life to others, allow that same power of those same words to bring life back into you. As you speak the word, God will allow it to come back into your own hearing so that it will rejuvenate and awaken something in your heart. Because out of the heart comes the issues of life. And whatever you hear again, with the real ear that's in your heart, will cause you to live again. So until next time, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. May he bless you in the city as well as in the field. May he bless your going out as well as your coming in. In Jesus' name, amen.
Grace and peace, everyone. This is Pastor Davis. I pray that the word you heard today not only blessed your life at this particular moment, but I pray that the word you heard has met you at the right time and in the right situation, so that you know that you have heard from the Lord Jesus Christ today. And now you have an opportunity to establish a vibrant relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're ready, we encourage you to take that leap of faith and give your life to Jesus Christ. Just simply admit that you're a sinner in need of forgiveness. Then confess your sins. Thank God for Jesus' death on the cross that paid the price for your sins. Then ask Jesus to be the Lord of your life. Pray this with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm sorry for the wrong things I've done. Please forgive me. I believe your son Jesus died on the cross for my sins and rose from the dead. Jesus, come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior. I surrender my life to you. Now, Father, help me to do your will. And thank you again for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. If you prayed that prayer, congratulations. God just gave you eternal life. Please let us know by emailing us at the address below, and someone will contact you. We look forward to hearing from you. We love you in Jesus' name. God bless you, and welcome to the family.